Councillor Lenny, Councillor Hogan.
And Councillor Mann has been substituted for Councillor
Brennan. Councillor Brennan is substituting Councillor Mann. And it's also a position that she's far up to. Is there any declarations of interest in relation to any item? Any matters of urgency to admit on the agenda? There are no matters on the agenda that require the exclusion of press and public. Therefore, I'll go to agenda item 2, which is the minutes of the 5th of November 2015. Submitted for approval. Is there a minute being read? Agenda item 4, page 57.
Then I'm going to go through agenda item.
Thanks, Chair. I'll introduce the report agenda item 3, but it does reflect the presentation that's been delivered by Group Manager Keane in regards to fire protection update. So I don't intend to go into any great detail around this report as that has been presented and will be concluded in great detail by Group Manager. Other than to say the report represents the work that's been undertaken over the previous 12 months. It looks at our legislative requirements that are placed on the authority in relation to the Regulatory Reform Order 2005, and it looks at the kind of functional planning processes that have been instigated by the protection departments to deliver against those requirements, particularly around our support to businesses, but also our requirements to enforce should that be required. It recognises some of the financial challenges and some of the challenges and changes that have been required over the period, and it looks towards a 5-year plan which will be delivering against some challenges, particularly around succession planning and ways of working in the future. Particularly identifies the introduction of a new management information system to ensure that the information that is gleaned by protection staff is readily available for operational staff, and that's built into the risk-based inspection programme. It also details within the report a couple of examples of where we have utilised the requirements under the order to ensure the safety of residents across Merseyside, and that is exemplified in paragraphs 20 through to 26. The report itself also goes into detail about our response to unwanted fire signals, and again, reducing the impact of an unwanted call to Merseyside Fire and Rescue Authority, allowing it to direct its resources to where they are of greatest need. And then it moves on to our contribution towards better regulation and taking away some of the burdens that are placed on our local businesses to ensure that they are fully conversant with the requirements placed on them, but equally they are supported to deliver the best possible outcomes for that business. And again, the report emphasises that point by going into the details around how we've utilised the conference to lead best practice but engage with the diverse business community. There's stipulations within the report between paragraph 36 through to 40, which details some of our protection activity over the period and how we've again utilised the knowledge and understanding from protection officers to train our operational crews in what to look out for in relation to fires in the built environment, because clearly the mechanisms that are in place to safeguard relevant persons equally apply to firefighters, better understanding what those safeguards are and being able to utilise them effectively to deal with any operational incidents. The report itself moves on to the requirements placed on us around planning and building regulations and culminates in capturing the legal responsibilities that are required by the authority in ensuring that we comply with the requirements placed on the statutory requirements to ensure that we are able to ensure the safety of the relevant persons across Merseyside. As I say, that is a very broad overview of the basis of the report. The report will be accompanied by a detailed presentation which will be concluded at the or will be finished at the conclusion of this meeting. But I'm happy to take any questions if there's anything specific about the content of the report, Chair.
Any questions?
Just, yeah, if I may, at the bottom of here on page 58, there's also been an increasing amount of requests for information about bariatric forms.
It's not a question really, it just really wants to comment on the work that's been done with the diverse business community. I think this is a fantastic piece of work. And I wonder whether, I know we're taking the lead on this, but how many other organisations around the country are doing the same kind of services?
In response to that, it's certainly a piece of work that we've calculated from the Merseyside perspective, and has just been alluded to by the group manager here. What we were, of course, you saw the lot of the prosecutions and the enforcement action that we're taking up until this point has been directed to a small business community, and with the potential for us to need to better understand why that was the case, and equally to understand what has resulted in that enforcement action being taken, and whether there's a lack of understanding of the requirements based on those businesses. And as has been identified, sometimes it's easier to kind of brush some of that stuff under the carpet and not overly concern yourself with it. However, it was a very brave and bold decision to say, okay, let's better understand why that is the case, and in doing so we will be better able to respond to the kind of needs of that business community. And the conference that was held in HVH course, which was started that, and it was very well subscribed, and we had farmers and services represented from across the UK, who have all recognised some of the significant challenges that are placed on them discharging their responsibilities around a particular group of communities. So there is an acknowledgement and this report fundamentally kind of acknowledges that. We are working now through Chief Fires Officers Association and become part of the business plan for CFOA to understand it better, to build a toolkit which will support farmers who serve in discharging their responsibilities, but also a toolkit that can be utilised by businesses to better comply with the requirements placed on them by the Fire Safety Order. So whilst we are leading that piece of work, we're leading it on behalf of the Chief Fires Officers Association, and it's something which has been readily embraced by the fire community, recognising the kind of challenges that they and the business face.
Thanks, Phil. Can I just ask, on case 32, how did we get to that situation where it was only found after the fire in the Liverpool school? How did it sort of miss all the planning and prevention to get to there?
Work in progress, yes, in relation to the circumstances and the detail. People don't appreciate that on occasions. It's down to a fire that we've identify some of the issues that are associated with some of the kind of the planning arrangements and so on and so forth. It's incumbent on us for when we do identify that to bring it to the attention of the relevant parties and put forward suggestions about how we can rectify those particular broad issues. We do and are involved in the planning and we work with planners to ensure that the fire safety measures in that building are appropriate to manage the kind of the risk and the risk of the relevant persons across the whole multitude. Now, then it moves on to the building phase and so on and so forth, and the sign off. And on occasion, and the work that we are progressing now is building and signed off as safe and compliant with maybe some little omissions there that haven't been readily identified as thoroughly as maybe we would want them to be in the first instance. And so it's better understanding that process. And unfortunately, if that isn't complied with in full, then there's the potential for fire to spread when we didn't necessarily perceive them to be those risks initially. And Guy is working now on a local but also a national fire forum to ensure where those issues are identified, we are putting in place measures to prevent that occurring again in the future.
Thanks, Ian. Peter?
Yes, just on the planning and building regulations, I'd just like to ask, do we give advice around sprinklers, particularly new buildings, and are developers obliged to take up, is the legislation to say we must have sprinklers in? If not, do we then, do we say we would recommend, we will give sign off to the building, but we would recommend that, you know, you put sprinklers in, because we often hear the reason for not having sprinklers is because of the cost.
Yeah, we make a fairly significant cap contribution to the park measured at that point. Pricing, we would always recommend, certainly in terms of where, you know, if they are lost, they are lost to the communities, the likes of schools and so on and so forth. That would be at the forefront of our minds to protect that building and that environment, because, you know, members will recognise if, for whatever instance, you know, there's a fire in the school, which means that pupils have to be displaced from that educational environment, they go somewhere else. That has an impact on them, but also has an impact on the receiving school, really, in regards to the education attainment of that whole kind of year of pupils. And so that's something which you can come to us to kind of keep bringing that to the attention of those who are planning and proposing new build schools or certainly significant work. And we do that on a regular basis. Now, what you find with the planning process is, you know, planners, architects and the like can put in place measures which they perceive to negate the requirements to install sprinklers. And we have an ongoing dialogue with those architects and planners around who are actually the most suitable way to manage fire risk in that locality. And we continue to promote and push the utilisation of sprinklers, but that is not always embraced by some. But that doesn't stop us trying, because we do genuinely believe that's not necessarily just about ensuring that someone can get out in the event of a fire, which is one thing, and that's fine, but it's also about protecting the community assets over a protected period of time. So everyone can leave the building, and, you know, we suffer no, you know, deaths and injuries as a result of that. But if the building then subsequently burns down, then that is a lost asset to the community. That way, a sprinkler system will protect the asset and will ensure that the kind of continuity of service, delivery, whatever that service is maintained. And so it's at the forefront of our mind when we are recommending the utilisation of sprinkler systems. And members will be aware, and we will bring a report back. We are still in the process of working on our sprinkler installation in marble towers. And we're also looking at sprinkler installation in the homes of people who are particularly vulnerable to safety or going through difficulties. So not only does it extend from the business environment, you know, the educational public service environment, but also into the homes of vulnerable people across Merseyside. And again, that's something we are very keen to push and promote. But sometimes it's down to the individuals who are paying the bills, I suppose. And whilst that is not something that we would want to care to acknowledge, that the harsh reality of some financial challenges that are being faced.
Just on the end of that, just a quick chat, please. I'm currently on a building scheme plan, which is going to have dimension units, and we looked at this and asked about it. But when I went out to an independent living scheme, one of the people who worked there said, one of the things they don't like about the sprinklers is that they can go off sometimes. They see that as a nuisance. I just wonder what the good argument is against that, please.
The good argument is it's not true.
Thank you.
In the most simplistic of ways, you know, people have a perception because they watch movies that every sprinkler in a building actuates when a fire occurs. That is not the case. You know, more often than not, it is one sprinkler that actuates, and it only actuates because there's actually a fire, and it extinguishes and suppresses the fire and any fire spread, and therefore mitigates any damage. But people who express those views are those in the nice spot where they don't want to be condescending, they're uninformed, and they haven't really gone into great detail and research to challenge their own beliefs around that, really. And so that's part of our education, that's part of the reason why we are progressing around Marlborough Towers and some of the other properties across Merseyside, so we are able to demonstrate, you know, in the physicality, the benefits of doing such. So, you know, Marlborough expands to other high-rise blocks across Merseyside because people see the benefits. And Marlborough is, again, particularly focused around people who are 55 plus, and again, which members will be aware, you know, as you get older, the risk of you dying in a fire increases, you know, and we want to cast to negate that as best we are able. So that's a real live demonstration of why fire suppression sprinkler systems should be installed in properties. So, you know,
reset that you put. We want to see the item four, which is 57, pass on to Phil.
Thanks, Chair. Again, this report related to our response to a request from members to better understand the implications of the Freedom of Information request on the authority. And the report proposes to request of members that members review the information in relation to Freedom of Information requests, and particularly the Freedom of Information Act 2000. What I would say from the outset is that Merseyside Fire and Rescue Authority adheres to and supportive of the Freedom of Information Act and values its role in allowing people to access information, giving them the right to find out about matters and decisions that affect them. Pray that be absolutely crystal clear around that. However, the use of the Act has become increasingly popular, and the volumes of Freedom of Information requests has increased over the recent years. The table on page 58 exemplifies that, which saw Freedom of Information requests in 2011 at 72, in 2014 at 138, and then up until November 9th, 2015 at 131. So it's clear evidence that the Freedom of Information requests coming through to Merseyside Fire and Rescue Authority has increased significantly over that period. And, members will also be aware that we've been receiving those Freedom of Information requests. It's a requirement for us to turn around that information within 20 days, unless we are able to provide a legitimate reason why we wouldn't provide that information. And even then, we would have to evidence that and reply to the particular individual who's requested the information. What we also recognise is that there are different courses of action that we could take. Providing the information, redacting the information, refusing to supply the information by applying an exemption, or determining that the work required to pull the information together is disproportionate, and then notifying the application of the data that's available by other means, or by determining the request is vexatious. And certainly, the Information Commissioner has said that when challenged around freedom of information and the number of requests, it is always available for an authority or an organisation to reject it on the basis that it's a vexatious request. But equally, members will appreciate the fact that that is quite challenging in that regard, because it seems very protectionist. It seems as though we would be withholding information from a public member or an organisation on that basis. And it's very difficult to legitimise that, is my view. And more often than not, the individuals, the staff who are seeking to provide that information will go way beyond what's expected them to provide the information as accurately as they are able to. But it does place demands on our organisation, particularly as our organisation continues to reduce in size. And when we look at our attempts to protect our frontline operational response, Thomas is that we would look at the support services that maintain the service outside of our operational firefighters. So our non-uniform colleagues spending a significant amount of time dealing with freedom of information requests. So the organisation is shrinking, but the demand around freedom of information is increasing. And so what the report does is it recognises that fact, it appreciates the fact that we get a multitude of different requests in, some from members of the public, some extended to journalists and so on and so forth, and representative bodies who are utilising the information, not for my view, how it was necessarily meant to be utilised in the first instance. And also we have requests coming from organisations and companies where they are seeking to achieve some competitive advantage, and I'm not sure, again, that was the basis of what the Freedom of Information Act was all about. But drawing all that in, and certainly it's probably being recognised because there's been an independent commission that has been invoked to review the Freedom of Information Act, and we have provided a response to that, saying we are certainly for legitimate, less than vexatious requests, and maybe a levy or a charge may be applicable to CAR to ensure that they are genuine and not repeated, and that would maybe prevent some of the prolific press requirements being met. It might start to change some of that thinking. However, the Information Commissioner has published a response in relation to that consultation, which argues against the introduction of fees, and, as I say, starts to suggest that authorities should use section 14, which is around vexatious requests to avoid responding to the ones that they believe to be, you know, vexatious in their very nature. However, you know, in regards to that, as I've previously stated, paragraph 12 describes, you know, the challenges around describing something as vexatious. That's not something we would want to be perceived as being defensive over the policies and procedures that we've adopted as an authority. I'm not sure we would want to be, or I certainly know we would want to be as transparent and as open as possible. But nevertheless, what does that mean in reality? In reality, it means that since July 2015 through November, 32 complete requests have been responded to. And a total of hours that have been attributed to that deal with those requests is 153 hours, which equates to 4.8 hours per request for information. When you extrapolate that over the 12-month period, it equates to 629 hours, which, again, in effect, is about 90 days of a person who has been responding to. And obviously, that's a collective person, because that's an hour of one department, 2 hours of another, 3 hours of another, and so on and so forth. But in totality, it's about 90 working days that's lost from this authority in responding to freedom of information requests at a time when we can better focus our attentions on the delivery of the service and say protecting the front line. However, you know, that is the kind of realities, and again, this is not about us, you know, challenging the utilisation of freedom of information, but certainly questions the actual its use in its broader sense of who actually uses it for what means. When you then, as part of our response to the consultation, we ask staff members about what they felt were the implications themselves, and they are detailed in paragraph 19. But what I would say, in kind of closing, and given that kind of clarity of 90 working days lost to respondents of freedom of information requests, just bring you back to the legal implications. Merseyside Fire and Rescue Authority has a duty under the Freedom of Information Act to deal with requests promptly, and in the event of no later than 20 working days after receipt of the requests, Merseyside Fire and Rescue Authority can exercise its rights under the Act if an exemption correctly applies, and in most cases the public interest test is then applied to ensure that any exemptions are correctly applied under those circumstances. So there are ways in which we can deal with them, but again, just to reiterate the point, in our attempts to be as open and transparent as possible, we are, you know, responding to each and every one, and it is incurring a significant cost associated with them of 90 days across the whole 12 months of the organisation, irrespective of who necessarily deals with them, or certainly who are members of certain teams who spend any more than lots of time dealing with those requests. And I can take any specific questions on that check.
It makes you think, doesn't it? I mean, what these individuals or companies are trying to achieve. That's 4.5 months of work, full-time work, is all day. What people happen to do. And, you know, it's been said the organisation isn't getting bigger, it's getting smaller and smaller. Because, and it doesn't actually, you know, better understanding of what is going on with people's minds out there. I said to Phil earlier, I mean, maybe there is the only way of being the charge, and if you want to get a copy of a birth certificate,
a couple of questions really, Chair. To repeat what Sharon said earlier, I didn't know what bariatric is.
Bariatric patient is someone who is tactfully obesely overweight. On occasions, those individuals will require kind of hospitalisation or some kind of, you know, medical treatment, and it's very difficult for them to get themselves out of their home. And so, firefighters will support our health colleagues in, you know, in assisting them out of their premises.
Okay, thanks a lot. To come back to the main question was to do with charges, and I thought two ways of looking at it. One, I think we're looking at commercial, especially the likes of solicitors asking for information. Is there the capacity to charge? And assuming that there isn't, because I'm sure there isn't, couldn't we possibly, in giving them the information they request, also give them at the bottom in bold red letters how much this information request has cost us in terms of money? So, for example, if I've done a piece of work and it's taken a day, what's the cost of that, and let the person requesting it know what they're charging us. Yeah?
I was just going to say, you can probably make the person who's requested feel a lot more happy because you've seen the amount of damage potentially they're doing to the organisation.
Well, also, well, true, they're wasting money sometimes on things.
Yes, but it's difficult to discriminate between the people involved in different requests are different. So dependent on the car, the individual and the scale of pay, their grade might have an impact. So if it's dealt with at a relatively low level, the cost is X. If it's dealt with and if it escalates up to the chief fire officer having to deal with information, provide information around future information requests, obviously it becomes more expensive. So we've tended to see a greater the actual physicality cost because it would have the potential to do that with me. Thought best to present to the authority around lost days. But the costs are, as you would appreciate, they are significant in that regard as well. But it's more around the opportunities costs lost by the staff who have other things to do, being taken away from their core day duties to focus on providing information. And that does extend to officers in the room, it would extend to myself, Deb, and other colleagues who have got strategic roles in the organisation who are spending some of their time from there providing that information. And some departments are disproportionately affected. So when you have knowledge and information, you approach the statistical information as well, provide information on response times and so on and so forth, and they have requests after requests after requests. They can provide that information, and we could say, it's too difficult, it's taking too much time, it's too costly for us to provide that. But we are trying, as a public sector organisation, we value the kind of the challenge by our communities, although we will continue to provide that, but it comes at a cost. So if not necessarily specifically a financial cost, we're drawing around opportunity costs and the direction of staff's time away from their core activity.
It concerns me that we've got all the minutes for all the meetings on the website. We have all the information out on Twitter and on Facebook. We've got the Hot News magazine, which the public have access to as well. And yet we're still getting requests for other information. Are the freedom of information requests, are they in the minutes of the meetings that they could be directed to instead of staff spending time? Obviously, the 90 days is a ridiculous amount of time, especially as like the scuts. It's ridiculous to spend that amount of time.
Where we are able to respond to a freedom of information request by directing the individual to or organisation to information that exists elsewhere, we will do. That still takes some time to respond. However, it's less laborious than having to pull that information together specifically to meet an individual's demands or needs. So if the information is existing, readily available through our website, we would always direct them to that area. But some of these things are so specific, we would never provide that information really readily available. It would be more directed to a certain specific set of circumstances, like between Monday and Friday last week, how many incidents we really go to. Now, we may be able to provide how many incidents we went to last month, last year. Not necessarily between Monday and Friday, so we would have to go away and do that level of detail and provide that information because we hold it. But as particular in response, where we have the information elsewhere, we would always direct the request to that information.
What happens then, Chair? Obviously, with the September medical emergencies now, that information obviously can't be shared, can it, about the medical emergencies? Only that we've attended, but not. Because you've got patient confidentiality.
Thanks, Chair. Yes, we would only provide information as in the number of calls that we've received and responded to, and where we've been able to make a life-saving intervention. It wouldn't be any more specific than that. It wouldn't detail the circumstances, it wouldn't detail any personal information, which is obviously restricted on the data protection related issue around patient confidentiality.
I just think as things get worse for everyone, just FOIs are going to increase for everyone requests for FOIs. I don't know why it can't be, well, you can have so many and then you pay. I mean, If you want an access medical record, I just paid £70 to get my mother's medical record to the Royal Hospital. So, in my opinion, if you really want something bad enough, in a certain respect, you should be, after so many requests, I think you should be liable to pay something. And I'm wondering, are you doing any, looking at this with any other organisations that are feeling the pressure as well?
Again, just in response to that, obviously the CAD consultation, the independent commission has looked at the information back now and what the implications are and where responses are on behalf of the authority. But you will also see paragraph 11, page 59, there's been 30,000 written submissions in relation to the demands placed on businesses, organisations and freedom of information. So some will be supportive, some will be against, but the fact of the matter is 30,000 people who've taken the time to respond to that. That is a significant number of people, so people have clearly got a strong opinion on it. So we will see, and we will report back to the authority the outcomes of that commission.
Peter, on the independent commission to have our MPs been briefed about this, because you know the time it's taking, the money it's taking to feed into that, or at least to have a comment down there in London on our behalf, because they're better placed, because what we see, I mean certainly in the local authority in Liverpool and especially around licensing, we do get vexatious requests all the time, and there might be a change, or letters to come in, and there might be a change in a word either at the beginning of the paragraph, in the middle or at the end. It's exactly the same, but just that change in word. And the amount of, and it's been alluded to in this report, the amount of work that generates, and it's basically from people who haven't got better things to do, you see, and you just come around and you want to do this, and a little bit of knowledge, you think they go away and they can, and then it's all on social media or whatever, we've done this and we've asked that, we've done the other. And it's, but what it's doing, it's the cost implications for us, money we can ill afford. So, I mean, if there's any way we can go down the route where it's like, you've submitted three FOIs in this year, after that, you're paying. And I think we should be pushing for that. And this will stop all this. It really will stop it, because whilst we can't hold our hands and say it's vexatious, we know they're vexatious. But you can see by what comes in, on my experience in Liverpool. And it sounds like we're getting the same here. And, you know, at some point, there's got to be a stop to it, because it's costing us money we can be better spent out there protecting the safety of our people out there and our workers.
So Jeff, just in response to that, certainly we share the contents of the report and the implications to this authority with our MPs.
Is that report noted?
Cheers. Yes.
Agenda item 5, page 63.
Thanks, Chair. Again, I'll introduce the report. It reflects the review of the CLG fire rescue attendance times, where the COVID was under the Home Office now, so it's totally difficult at the time of writing the report, which is accurate and reflecting the fact that we sat on the part of the communities and local government. Well, the purpose of the report is to request that members scrutinise the attached report and appendix A containing analysis of the fire rescue services attendance times. The data in the report has been sourced from DCLG and compares Merseyside fire rescue attendance time for 12 fire and primary fires against fellow metropolitan fire rescue services and more broadly UK fire rescue services. The purpose of the report is a briefing paper, and it does reflect the kind of the response times across England between 2014 April and March 2015. The key issues.
Just be informed, because we're not quorum, we can't carry on.
Well, we can't make a decision on
it.
Boss needs to go now. Actually was quiet because the person could hear the conversation and hear from where they were. That's good, it's
happening.
Would you ever never have a joint?
No, I will continue. At an legal level, the CLG report provides the following summary: that the average response time to a dwelling fire was 7 minutes 45, this is across England. That the average response time to attend a dwelling fire involving a casualty was 7 minutes 32 seconds. The average response time to all primary fires was 8 minutes 43. This is the average response across the whole of England. The average response time for predominantly urban areas, urban fire and rescue services, was 7 minutes 42. Really urban, but related directly to metropolitan fire rescue services, as clear as Merseyside is. The average response time to rural fire and rescue services to primary fires was 10 minutes 50 seconds. And during 2014-15, all metropolitan fire rescue services had a slower attendance time than previous years, and I'll come back to that point in a second. And then you compare that with Merseyside's response standards and average attendance time. Merseyside has the fastest attendance time out of all metropolitan fire rescue services of 6 minutes 35 when related to accidental dwelling fires, and is only a little bit slower than Cleveland Fire and Rescue Service, who has the quickest response across UK England fires and rescue services in a broader sense. When you compare the English average of 7 minutes 45, Merseyside Fire and Rescue Service was well ahead of this performance.
Yeah.
That in relation to primary fires then, for members, you know, primary fires do incorporate dwelling fires, but they also incorporate a number of other fires, such as fires in factory units, fires in hospitals, fires in vehicles and the like. But Greater London has the quickest attendance time for all primary fires, with 6 minutes 51, only marginally quicker than Merseyside, which is 6 minutes 54. And again, you know, only Cleveland's quicker with 6 minutes 24 across the whole of the UK. So in effect, what does that tell you as members? Merseyside Fire and Rescue Service has maintained its immediacy of its response. It is quick in regards to responding to fires. That's notwithstanding the fact that the weight of our response, due to the reduction in the number of fire plants, has gone from 42 to 28, you know, has had a disproportionate effect in that regard. So we are still quick, we maintain a fast and immediate response, but the weight of response to second, third, tenth and appliances are slower by the fact that the main region is the fact that we have less of them distributed across Merseyside. What I would also bring members to attention back to is the bullet point which is related to during 2014-15, all metropolitan fire and rescue services had a slower attendance time than in previous years. What we'd seen between 2010 and up until 2014 was us getting quicker, our response getting quicker, and that may be down to, you know, our appliances and so on and so forth, our better understanding and management of risk, better deployment of our operational appliances and crews. But 2014 nationally, you know, certainly across England, has been the first time when that is reflected across all fire rescue services. So we have become slower in how we respond to fires more recently. Whether that is something which is a continued trend, you know, we don't know as yet, because it's the first time that's occurred 14-15 in comparison with the previous years. What I would also just bring members' draw members' attention to, that the way the kind of calculation and the methodology that we've applied in regards to the average response times reflects DCLG's methodology, not necessarily the Merseyside methodology that we've applied through our consultation process, but we have, you know, benchmarked our delivery against what is benchmarked kind of across England and Wales, and so that those findings are as is. So as I say, in regards to a comparison for Metropolitan Fire and Rescue Services in relation to dwelling fires, we are the quickest Metropolitan Fire and Rescue Service in the UK. We are only just probably the second fastest across England because of the fact that Cleveland are faster. And again, that extends to the primary fires, with London, Cleveland being quicker in regards to their operational response to primary fires across the whole of England. And I'm happy to take any questions or any specific in relation to either the report or the appendices.
Thank you. Chair, can we just bring to attention number 9? I'm sure that's gone in by mistake to be worded that way. Obviously, it should be worded in praise of the staff, both operational and support, that we're managing to achieve the times. I think that's just the standard thing we've put in there, isn't it? But I don't think it should be changed on this report to praise the staff for what they've achieved, all the staff.
Yeah, absolutely, I appreciate that. I suppose the way that the report being constructed, because it was around the data sources, it probably doesn't make sense to staff implication, but what he pointed out is absolutely correct in the fact that the reason we have maintained those operational standards is better utilisation of our data, our intelligence, to put our resources in the right place at the right time to make the right response. But it also extends it to our firefighters on fire stations recognising the fact that we want to, you know, minimise the length of our response, and so they are quick to respond to incidents and calls that we are received. And that also extends into fire control in how we call, handle and manage the time taken between a call being received, mobilising the resource to respond to a fire, and then continuing to take information from a call